Meine sehr verehrten Damen und Herren, sehr geehrter Herr Professor Diamond, sehr geehrte Frau Professor Jesi-Jolo, sehr geehrte Frau Dr. Klausing. Mein Name ist Sophia Helena Novak und ich begrüße Sie ganz herzlich in der Michael Blumenthal Akademie des Jüdischen Museums Berlin zu unserer heutigen Veranstaltung zum Thema Glauben Sie an Wunder? Es ist unser fünfter Vortragsabend im Rahmen der Ringvorlesung Wissen und Glauben in Judentum und Islam. Heute Abend wollen wir uns dem Problem des Wunders widmen. Das Wunder ist des Glauben liebstes Kind, sagt Goethes Faust. Wunder und Wundergeschichten sind ein Fundament, ein Rückgrat vieler religiöser Narrative. Das Christentum ohne die Auferstehung, Judentum und Islam ohne das Wunder der Offenbarung der beiden heiligen Bücher, der Tora und des Koran, sind nicht denkbar. Zugleich empfinden viele Menschen, wenn nicht eine direkte Ablehnung, so doch ein gewisses Unbehagen angesichts der Wundererzählungen, von denen ihre religiösen Traditionen berichten. Heute Abend wollen wir daher fragen, wie das Judentum und der Islam diesem Skeptizismus früher wie heute begegnen. Können das Judentum und der Islam den Glauben an konkrete Wunder gegenüber dem Vorwurf der Naivität oder Irrationalität rechtfertigen? Oder kann man heute nicht mehr an Wunder glauben? Wir freuen uns sehr, dass wir zu diesem Thema Herrn Professor James Diamond und Frau Isra Erzi-Icholo gewonnen haben. Professor Diamond ist Professor für jüdische Studien an der Universität of Waterloo. Frau Erzi-Icholo ist Professorin für Religionswissenschaft an der St. Joseph's Universität in Philadelphia. Falls Sie eine Übersetzung brauchen ins Deutsche, können Sie sich hier an der Seite Kopfhörer nehmen. Nein? Also, nochmal? Ach so, okay, draußen. Gut, können Sie sich draußen nehmen. Ich möchte jetzt das Wort an Frau Klausing übergeben und wünsche uns allen einen schönen Abend. Vielen Dank.
Ja, guten Abend und vielen Dank, dass ich zum dritten Mal dabei sein darf in dieser Reihe der Ringvorlesung. Ich begrüße als erstes Herrn Professor Diamond hier auf dem Podium, der den ersten Vortrag halten wird. Ich werde ganz kurz etwas zu seiner Biografie sagen. Und zwar ist Professor Diamond, hat den Lehrstuhl inne für jüdische Studien an der Universität von Waterloo in Ontario in Kanada, ist das, und hat seine Promotion im Bereich religiöse Studien und mittelalterlichem jüdischen Denken an der Universität von Toronto ebenfalls in Kanada absolviert. Er ist außerdem Jurist, hat seinen Master in Jura an der New York Universität erhalten und hat mehrere preisgekrönte Publikationen herausgebracht, Monographien herausgebracht, die vor allen Dingen um seinen Hauptforschungsschwerpunkt, den mittelalterlichen Gelehrten Maimonides, handeln. Und die letzte in dieser Reihe trägt den Titel Maimonides and the Shaping of the Jewish Canon, die unter anderem auch ausgezeichnet worden ist mit einem Buchpreis. Er ist wie viele unserer Referenten in dieser Ringvorlesung nicht nur Akademiker, sondern auch ein aktives Mitglied seiner Gemeinden und trägt insofern dazu bei, dass er als Visiting Scholar in verschiedenen Gemeinden in Toronto, New York und dergleichen in den vergangenen Jahren auch jetzt unterwegs ist und so dort beiträgt für einen Dialog zwischen Akademie und gelebter Religion, wenn ich das so sagen darf. Ja, ich begrüße Herrn Diamond hier auf dem Podium. Er möchte den Vortrag unter folgendem Titel halten. Glaubst du an Wunder? Und zwar im Fall für das Judentum hier zu uns sprechen. Ich begrüße Herrn Diamond hier auf der Bühne.
Guten Abend, Erev Tov, good evening. My German is good enough to know that my mother would have been very proud of that introduction. Thank you very much. So tonight's topic is, as you all know, miracles. And in order to give you the Jewish position, some of you might know when my students ask me, what is the Jewish position? And if somebody answers the Jewish position on any issue, I would say on any issue, then I tell them run for the hills. just leave, because there is no, there hasn't been for a long, long time, a central authority or a particular person that deals with dogma. And so miracles is no different than any other issue. So what I'd like to do is talk to you a bit, give you a bit of a survey of how Judaism or Jewish thinkers have dealt with miracles from the Bible to the modern times, and then, you know, allow you to kind of maybe pick and choose, and maybe we can have a conversation. Of course, any talk related to Jewish thought must, for it to be Jewish, must engage with the tradition. That is the classical, in my opinion, the classical traditional texts, starting with the Bible. Of course, the Bible is a small part of it. And then on to the rabbinic period in the first centuries, and then the medieval period, and then on to the modern. If you don't engage that tradition, it could be great thought, but I'm not sure I would call it Jewish thought. So in your source one, perhaps the first real discussion of miracles starts with actually somebody being skeptical about miracles in the Bible itself, and that is Sarah. So when Sarah hears that, and she's long past the age of the childbearing age, and she hears that she will have a child, which has to be a miracle, she's very skeptical. She's very skeptical. And then she's rebuked. There's a response in Genesis 18:14. Hayipale me Hashem davar. I'll say it in English. Is anything too wondrous for the Lord? I will return to you at the same season next year, and Sarah shall have a son. So there is actually already a modern, really, approach in the Bible itself. You have a woman actually voicing a skeptical approach to miracles. She's rebuked, and on that, a prominent medieval commentator, Rabbi David Kimchi, says on that word is anything too wondrous. Wondrous in modern Hebrew is used often for something that is astonishing. Doesn't have to be a miracle. These matters appear miraculous in the eyes of human beings, and they cannot fathom how such things can be. However, in light of God's omnipotence, so here we have the importance of miracles in terms of faith in God. Because according to some definitions of God, definitions of perfection, one of those definitions of perfection includes omnipotence, all-powerful. And therefore, this is a statement that refers to that power. But it goes further than that. He who created the universe has no problem making changes in his universe. That is, this verse really voices something that assumes something else before we reach a belief in God as having the ability to perform miracles, and that is, he is the creator of the world. Unlike in a lot of pagan theology, he transcends the world. He is not part of the world, and therefore he's not subject to those laws, perhaps, that govern the world. Therefore, essential to the idea of miracles or God's intervention, meaning the traditional idea of miracles in the world, is the idea that precedes that he is the creator of the world. And therefore, if he is the creator of the world, he also creates the laws that govern the world, and therefore, he can also change those laws. Now, when we get to the classical rabbinic period, which really is the period that is the formative period for what we now call Judaism. That is, Jews are no longer, at least for Judaism, no longer biblical Jews. A lot of my students make this mistake. A lot of people make this mistake. That is, it is Bible, but through the lens of the way ancient Jewish interpreters understood virtually every verse in the Bible and through that lens. And so when we get to the to that period, which is the first 4 or 5 centuries in the Common Era, we have an unease. Not throughout. It's a very large body of work, the Talmud. I'm not going to be here for a couple of years, so I can't really go through all the opinions. But across that voluminous corpus, there is an unease, because when we get to that period, there's a discomfort that people may misperceive the miracles that are reported in the Bible as performed through magic, and the Bible itself doesn't really like magic. The Bible itself, in Deuteronomy, for instance, and in Leviticus, outlaws, with very serious consequences, all kinds of pagan magic. So in source 2, I have a few sources that reflect this unease. Oh, where is it? This? No, not this. This. Sorry. You see my age? I have a problem with this stuff. Okay. PowerPoint is not my forte. But in source 2, you have a number of different passages in the Talmud that reflect this. So the first one, source 2a, is Moses, and they're on the lamb that is there, is running away from the Egyptians. They're stuck. They have a large body of water in front of them. And Moses kind of turns to God. God says to him in Exodus 14, 15, "Why do you cry out to me? Tell the Israelites to go. Advance. Just go and go across the sea." The rabbis understand this as a kind of rebuke to a purely miraculous view of the world. That is, God will, you cannot conduct yourself as if God will always come to the rescue. And so the rabbinic interpretation is, why have you cried out to me? This teaches us that Moses stood in prayer. Whereupon God said to him, "Now is no time to pray. When Israel is placed in trouble," that is, when your people are facing a crisis, you are the leader, you have to lead. "Don't worry about me. Don't turn to me. Do what you have to do. Do what you have to do." So that's one source. The second one, which is 2b, is a very interesting one, which is a battle against the kind of the arch enemy, becomes really in subsequent Judaism the symbol of evil. That is, according to many rabbinic interpreters, for instance, Nazi Germany fit this definition. They are the inheritors, the successors to the ancient nation of Amalek. In that depiction of the war, Moses goes up to a mountain, and the people fight at the foot of the mountain. The soldiers are in the battlefield. Moses is at the top of the mountain. His hands are up. When he gets tired, they're up, the people are winning. The soldiers are winning. When he gets tired and they're down, they're being defeated on the battlefield. So this is a very prominent rabbinic passage, and they say, "You mean to say that Moses' hands, they're afraid of magic, are the ones that are accomplishing defeat or victory?" No. They say, this teaches us, as long as Israel would look upwards and subject their hearts to God, then they prevailed. Then they were victorious. When they weren't looking towards God and were only interested in their own strategic interests, then they were on the verge of defeat. So what that means is very interesting, that what the rabbis are saying is, don't read this as a magical event. That is, Moses is not doing what pagans do, and that is, there's some ritual which forces the gods to do your bidding. That's not our God. What he's doing is simply a reflection. What Moses is doing with the arms up and the arms down is a reflection of what's going on in the minds of those in the battlefield. If they lose their perspective and think they're fighting for some strategic interest, for their own glory, let's say, then they start to lose. If they have their eye on what is important about this battle, which, by the way, is interpreted by the rabbis to be a battle that has no strategic interest except to defeat evil, then they are victorious. The final 2C is fascinating. I need to talk about this because even what I've done is covered kind of war, escape from war, confronting war, and then even in the field of Jewish law. Fascinating, fascinating passage. There is an argument between two opposing parties. One of the parties who's in the minority cites God. Miraculous events happen to support his position. The majority opinion, which is against him, says, we don't listen to that. We don't, in effect, listen to God. Miracles no longer play a part in us deciding what the proper law is. The proper law is decided according to human reasoning, our capabilities. We leave God out of the picture, and therefore, in our opinion, what rules is democracy, and majority opinion wins, and therefore God has no place in the rabbinic academy. Miracles have no place in the rabbinic academy. Quite a startling passage about the unease with miracles, the unease with people coming around who perhaps consider themselves miracle workers and then gathering around them a community that might not fit with Jewish law or with rabbinic authority. Now, in the Middle Ages, you have two very prominent, I would consider them the two most important Jewish thinkers, but they couldn't be more different than each other. One, the rationalist par excellence, Maimonides, lived from 1138 to 1205, largely operated in Egypt in an Islamic culture, and Nachmanides, who lived a bit after him, more of a mystical bent. In their positions are completely opposed to each other. That is, Maimonides was a rationalist and tended to see miracles as built into the natural order. That is, God at creation already pre-programmed the natural law so that at certain points in time, let's say the splitting of the Red Sea would happen, or those miracles that happened in Egypt. So what Maimonides is doing as a rationalist, he cannot stand something that interrupts natural law. So what he does is make miracles part of the natural law. And he actually has rabbinic traditions that support him with a little bit of interpretation. Nachmanides actually sees everything in the world as miracles. Everything in the world, and I think that it has, Nachmanides is reflecting a parallel movement, you'll hear from my colleague in Islam, a parallel movement that sees everything in the world as miracles. And meaning, there is no law. There is no law of physics. There's no law of nature. At every instant in time, God is performing something so that that thing can happen. So there are overt miracles, like the splitting of the sea, but those who can see the world properly see a miracle in everything. Of course, that is anathema. That is really, really makes Maimonides uncomfortable because that destroys natural law. That destroys physical law. That destroys science. And therefore, you can never really say, no scientist can say what's going to happen because everything is a miracle. Everything is a miracle. So two very, very distinct positions that Jews are free, I think, to choose from. Maimonides, by the way, is the one responsible for introducing dogma, that is a set of beliefs, before the 12th century The rabbis never listed a set of beliefs that Jews must believe in, but even he, miracles is not one of them. Miracles is not one of them. It's not something you must believe in order to remain within the faith. Now, we get up to the modern period, and there are, of course, assaults on the notion of miracles, assaults on really everything to do with the Bible, notoriously by another famous Jew himself. It is interesting that probably the most prominent atheists today are Jewish. Sam Harris, even Christopher Higgins, found out later in life that he was Jewish. So he was wont to say that the monotheists, I like them the best because they're almost there. They believe they've narrowed it down to one God. All they have to do is go one more step and they're in my school of atheism. So he basically eviscerated really an assault on the Bible, on biblical authority, and therefore with that, an assault on the reports of miracles. That is, he distinguished between the writers and their subjective understanding of the world and the reports in the Bible as literal reports of miracles. So what I'd like to do in the next few minutes, if I have maybe 5 minutes or so, is take you up to the modern period. So this is something I would teach an entire course on. So I've taken you to my 20th lesson with my students, but I think I've given you a little bit of a picture of the groundwork that we need for Jewish thought to address this issue in the modern period. And of course, when we get to the modern period, we're dealing virtually exclusively with German-born Jews. That is, German-born Jews that emigrated, as you all know, for good reasons, are really the most prominent thinkers that molded, perhaps I would say, the future of Jewish thought. I'm going to mention three of them. Martin Buber, Franz Rosenzweig, and Hans Jonas. Maybe Hans Jonas is a little bit less known. But Martin Buber took the Bible very seriously, wrote quite a bit about the Bible. From my point of view, maybe one of the most sensitive readers of the Bible, understood the Bible as a record of divine human encounters. That is, this is not to be taken literally. Neither did Maimonides think that the Bible was to be taken literally. That's another lecture. You can invite me maybe another year for this. But Martin Buber, in a very, very different way, understood this as real. That is, real events as filtered through the way people experienced these events. That is, people truly experienced these events that are reported to us as miracles, as somehow encounters, and this is very big in Martin Buber's thought. Some of you may have read some of his philosophy, most famous for a book called Ich und Du, I and Thou, which is all about dialogue and really encountering relationships rooted in encounters between people and between human beings and God. And so the Bible is to be taken seriously, but seriously in the sense of these are reporting authentic encounters between human beings and the world where they experienced God as what he calls a thou, a thou. Franz Rosenzweig has another very, very prominent Jewish German thinker who actually, he died very young, translated the Bible with Martin Buber. Martin Buber finished it after he died into German. Very, very prominent translation in German. Says the following fascinating, actually, statement about a miracle in the Bible. A Gentile or a non-Israelite prophet, Balaam, whose donkey ass, let's say, speaks to him. A miracle. So Franz Rosenzweig, who agrees with Martin Buber on some things, says the following: all the days of the year, Balaam's talking ass may be a mere fairy tale, But on the Sabbath, so a lot of you may know, every Sabbath there's a passage read in the Bible until the five books of Moses are completed annually. Now, anyways. So he says, if you talk to me about it now, you know, it's a fairy tale, it's in the past. But when I hear it on that day that I hear it in the synagogue, and I hear it being read on the podium from the Torah scroll, it's certainly not a fairy tale, but that which is communicated to me, provided I am able to fulfill the command of the hour, namely to open my heart. Sorry, that's a typo. That's my technological ability. That is, what he's saying is a bit like Buber, but that is, when I'm in the heart of Jewish ritual, I experience this miracle perhaps as close as possible to the way the biblical authors or the biblical writers experienced it. Quite fascinating. So now I want to get to really what is very important, especially where I'm standing here in Berlin. Today I wandered around to the memorials, and I've lived with this all my life. Perhaps very important, that is, can we still talk about miracles, at least in the way they're traditionally understood after Auschwitz? How can we talk about miracles when 6 million people, 6 million Jews, many, many others, of course, died and God performed no miracle? God performed no miracle after the first one died, after the second one died, or before the first one died. How can we still speak about miracles? And by the way, Auschwitz raises not just an old problem. The quantity, the volume of the evil raises a qualitative problem. There is a qualitative problem after Auschwitz that Job didn't know. Job, the book of Job, deals with a personal problem, great evil that befell his family. But when we get to Auschwitz, when we get to the Second World War and the Shoah, we're dealing with a whole new problem. Hans Jonas says that perhaps we need to sacrifice something that I started with in that first source that medieval commentator said, of God's omnipotence. That goes back to the creation. That is, if omnipotence is a logical kind of consequence of God being the creator, perhaps in light of what happened, we need to formulate a new idea of God. And I think this makes absolute philosophical sense. That is, a God who limits himself, who has limited himself, and has decided he's given up on omnipotence, on all-powerful. That is, we can't give up, if we want to hold on to God, on his goodness, because then what do we have left? But we can perhaps give up on omnipotence. And actually, I find this within the Jewish tradition, because it feeds into a Kabbalistic idea that's very prominent in the mystical tradition, that the entire creation of the world, that God as a creator, at the very foundation of the world, needed to actually limit himself. He needed to withdraw from the world in order for the world to exist. The question was, God is everywhere. If God is everywhere, where is there space for the world? Where is there space for human beings? This also, therefore, he limited himself. He withdrew, and there was a space for the world. Traditional commentators also say that God limited his power in terms of what human beings can do. And so if human beings have freedom of choice, therefore God kind of stepped back and said, you know what, you can kind of direct your lives, go whatever way you want, for good or for evil. For good or for evil. So it's not without its problems, clearly. I would say a lot of my colleagues in the Orthodox world who I grew up with, I went to rabbinic academies, to what are called yeshivot, I don't think would accept this. But from a philosophical point of view, perhaps. And by the way, Hans Jonas, along with Hannah Arendt and others, were ironically a famous Nazi philosopher, Martin Heidegger, his best students, some of his most prized students, were Jewish. Were Jewish. Ironic. Ironic. So I'll just end off with another approach that wouldn't accept this approach. An anecdote where people, rabbinic figures living post-Holocaust, still see God's hand in the world. And this is an anecdote. In 1948, after the State of Israel was declared, and there was a war, the War of Independence, there was victory on the Israeli side, and many of the fighters in the Israeli army were Holocaust survivors, And so they came back. Oh, sorry, I don't have that source. And so they came back, Ben-Gurion, David Ben-Gurion, the first prime minister of Israel, who was not partial to religion, who was a socialist, thought that maybe we can kind of get rid of religion, was interested in kind of a national rebirth of Jews rather than a religious rebirth, turned to the first chief rabbi, the first Ashkenazic chief rabbi, a very, very learned rabbi, Isaac Levi Herzog, and he said to him, look, you know, look, they accomplished this with no miracles, no miracles. They fought on the battlefield and they prevailed. And these were Holocaust survivors that just a few years ago were literally skeletons when they survived the war, perhaps even as close to what they called in the concentration camps, Musulman, Musulman. So the chief rabbi turned to him and said, David, you're wrong. These are the miracles. These are the miracles. So again, I'll just end with perhaps two points of view. Neither accept Hans Jonas's point of view. You have those secularists, atheists perhaps, that reject miracles altogether. And then you have, I think the chief rabbi here is really articulating something along the lines of Buber and Rosenzweig, though I think he probably wouldn't say that he's in that camp. That is, these people are a symbol of miracles. They experience this as miracles. Who are we to say that this is not a miracle in their encounters with God? So if I can maybe just finish with one final anecdote. All of you, many of you might know the famous play, Fiddler on the Roof, Fiddler on the Roof. So Fiddler on the Roof, there, those of you who know the play, Tevye has some daughters. He wants to marry off one daughter to an old rich guy in the village, but she's in love with a guy named Muttel. Finally, Muttel, Tevye agrees to that Muttel will marry his daughter. And he sings a song in Fiddler on the Roof. And he says this, when David slew Goliath, that was a miracle. When God gave us manna in the wilderness, that was a miracle too. But of all God's miracles, large and small, is the one I thought could never be. God has given you to me. Miracle of miracles. But, this sounds kind of trivial, but I think it actually highlights some of the things I've spoken about. That is, in his experience, this is an encounter with God that rivals all those miracles. And who are we to say whether this is a miracle or whether this is not a miracle? Whether somebody has experienced something, is it an objective miracle? I don't know. I'm not one to judge. So I'll leave you with Tevye and Fiddler on the Roof, and hopefully my colleague, I'm sure, will illuminate you on the Islamic background, and hopefully we'll have a very fruitful discussion after. Thank you very much.
Vielen Dank, Herr Professor Diamond, für diesen Vortrag. Ich begrüße als nächste Referentin hier auf dem Podium Isra Yazıcıoğlu. Sie ist Professorin für islamische Studien an der St. Joseph oder St. Joseph University in Pennsylvania. Sie forscht vor allen Dingen zur Koraninterpretation in der Moderne und zur islamischen Theologie und Spiritualität. Und ihr Fokus, oder sie hat sehr intensiv geforscht zu einem modernen Denker oder einem sehr bedeutenden modernen Denker und Theologen, Said Nursi. Und hat 2013 ein Buch zu unserem Thema heute herausgebracht, und zwar die koranischen, also wie man die koranischen Wunder verstehen kann in der modernen Zeit. Und in dieser Publikation bringt sie muslimische Denker ins Gespräch mit westlichen Denkern. Sie hat einige Arbeiten verfasst, also einige Artikel verfasst, die sich im weitesten Sinne auch mit dem Thema, was wir heute besprechen, auseinandersetzen. Zum Beispiel mit der Abrahamsgeschichte im Koran, also Abraham und sein Messer, die Interpretation des abrahamischen Opfers in der muslimischen Tradition ist ein Artikel, den sie herausgebracht hat. Und zum Beispiel eine Interpretation der Geschichte des Propheten Hiob, die sich um Prüfung, also um die Idee der Prüfung, Geduld und Gebet in der islamischen Tradition kümmert. Isra Yazici Oğlu hat ihren Abschluss in islamischen, also muslimisch-christlichen, im muslimisch-christlichen Dialog gemacht am Hartford Seminary und hat ihren Doktor gemacht, auch in religiösen Studien an der Universität von Virginia. Und sie ist, wie unser Vorredner, jemand, der ihre akademische oder die ihre akademische Arbeit auch in den ehrenamtlichen Bereich hineinträgt und ist Mitglied eines Teams, das sich für islamische Spiritualität einsetzt, das Receiving Nur heißt. Das heißt so viel, also Nur ist ein arabisches Wort, das heißt Licht, also Licht empfangen würde man sozusagen damit übersetzen. Ich begrüße Frau Yazici Oğlu hier oben, bitte Sie nach oben und ich freue mich auf Ihren Vortrag.
Hello everyone. I'm very happy to be here and thank you for Jewish Museum in Berlin for the invitation. The title of my presentation is Miracles in the Quran and a word with awe, gratitude and freedom. The Quran contains many miracle stories, from Abraham not burning in blazing fire, to Moses' staff turning into a serpent, to Saint Mary's conceiving Jesus as a virgin. Such miracle stories in the Quran may sound strange to many of us in this day and age. It is often thought that one either believes in the historical accuracy of these miracle stories or rejects them as untrue. Interestingly, regardless of whether we believe in these miracle accounts or not, we tend to limit the scope of religion to supernatural. It is as if we know our way in the world, we know our way, we understand the regular, ordinary life, and religion is irrelevant there. It is often assumed that religion is only relevant on issues that are kind of strange, extraordinary, miracles being one of them. In tonight's talk, we shall question such a view, we will ask questions like, why do we think miracles are impossible? And if they are possible, why do they matter for us now? Because I'd like to argue that from a Quranic perspective, if we think a bit more, we can maybe consider miracles as invitations to wonder, and gratitude, to awe, and they might indicate, if, dare I say, a solution to some of the deepest existential issues that we have, namely the problem of transience and human freedom. Oh, I also need to press something here. Miracle? Oh. Yes. Oh, so this is my main sources up front. Of course, I'm looking at the Quran and using it in many various translations. Mohammed Asad is one of my favorites, who was a European Jew, actually, as a side note. A lot of the things that are in this presentation are based on Said Nursi's work, a contemporary Muslim theologian who died in the 1960s, and his Epistles of Light. Yemen Abu Ghinaya is one of the kind of main interpreters of his work. She has a work that's called Living with Genuine Tawheed, that's kind of more for the common person. So a lot of ideas are related to her work as well. And then many other sources, medieval sources, especially Ghazali and Rumi, but others as well. These are some of the main sources. Now, we might think, we might be saying, I believe makers are impossible, and there are good reasons for that, because I believe natural causes always do the same thing, so they can't do a different thing. The other reason could be that laws of nature never change. They're always the same. So I don't believe in miracle stories. Tonight, we're going to challenge that a little bit. Not too much pressure. You don't have to take it, but we're just going to question that a little bit, and we'll ask really. The other thing is, somebody might be saying, I believe in miracles in the scripture, and we're going to press that a little bit as well. We're going to ask the question, so what? If you believe in a miracle that happened thousands of years ago, so what? What is the significance of that? Because oftentimes, people who believe in miracle stories, they don't think they're relevant for today. You know, when I teach a class on this, so I start by asking, and it's a Catholic school, even though not all the students are Catholic. So I say half of the world believes in the virgin birth story, that Mary had Jesus as a virgin. But how many of you would believe in such a person today if a pregnant woman came to you and said, I'm pregnant, but nobody touched me? I don't think anybody in the world would believe that at this time. So what does it? Are these stories irrelevant stories? What are? Could they have a significance for us? So that will be something that will be inviting you to reflect with me on. So that's the thesis. Miracle stories can be considered from being strange to something that invites us, giving us an exciting invitation to rethink what we take for granted, and inviting us to embrace things in gratitude and wonder. I'll start here. This is in the Quran. There's an interesting puzzle. Because, as I said, the Quran talks a lot about various prophets and their miracles, but at the same time, it also questions the demand for miracles. For those people who are asking for miracles, the Quran tells them that the job of the prophet is not to be a wonder maker, but to convey a message. Here's a passage, a translated passage from the Quran. They, and these are the bad guys, they say, "We will not believe for you, Muhammad, in brackets, until you make a spring gush out of the ground for us, or until you have a garden of date palms and vines and make rivers pour through them, or make the sky fall on us in pieces, as you claimed will happen, or bring God and angels before us face to face, or have a house made of gold, or ascend into the sky. Even then, we will not believe in your ascension until you send a real book down for us to read." I know that's a big list of things. The answer is, "Say, Muhammad, glory be to my Lord, am I anything but a mortal, a messenger?" Again, elsewhere in the Quran, Muhammad is called to say, "I am only a human being like you, to whom has been revealed that your God is one." What does it mean for God to be one? This is something we want to explore a little bit later today. But one hint is that it means that God is the only source, an unending source of power and beauty. Instead of miracles, the Quran calls people to pay attention to the world around them, to the nature around them. And so here's a passage out of many from the Quran again. "In the creation of the heavens and the earth, in the alteration of night and day, in the ships that sail the seas with goods for people, in the water which God sends down from the sky to give life to the earth when it has been barren, scattering all kinds of creatures over it, in the changing of the winds and clouds that run their appointed courses between the sky and the earth, there are signs," ayat in Arabic, in all these for those who use their minds. This is from Surah 2, verse 164. So then the ordinary world, supposedly according to this view, is filled with signs pointing to the transcendent. Now, how is that so? So one way to think about this is the question what we take for granted. We tend to think that we understand ordinary events. And a number of Muslim scholars noted that the whole point of the scripture is to push us beyond what we think we understand. There's this veil of familiarity that appears as we go through life, and the whole point of the scripture is to kind of rip apart that curtain, that veil. We think we understand ordinary events, and there's some good reason for that. For instance, I drink coffee and I feel energized, and this happens again and again, and I say coffee wakes me up. I water my plant, it flowers, water gives life, I conclude. Natural causes create their effects. All of this sounds straightforward, logical, and clear. In reality, such conclusions are far from being straightforward, even there I say logical. But we don't usually stop to think more because things are too familiar. There's nothing simple about a seed becoming a flower, but because it happens all the time, in such large quantities, imagine spring coming all to the North Hemisphere all at the same time. There are way too many flowers all over. We stop thinking about them. So we stop even noticing things around us. And so that's why a number of Muslim theologians thought that that was the whole point of the prophets being sent, to kind of declutter that habit thinking, superficial thinking, according to them. But how do we do this? I mean, how do we start thinking differently about regular things? Okay, there's something. So the common sense approach that I have just mentioned about natural causes is that because two things consistently appear together, we say one creates the other. So a natural cause and its effect consistently appear together and disappear together. In the case of water and the flower, if I put the flower, I mean water, you know, the seed becomes a flower. If I don't put the water, the seed dies. And so if there's no water, there's no flower. And then it is only common sense to think that, well, water causes or creates the flower. So this is common sense, but the Quran has other plans. The Quran talks about minding the mismatch between what we call as the cause and what we call as its effect. What is the mismatch? The mismatch is between the qualities of the water and the qualities of the flower. The flower indicates comprehensive knowledge and creative power, whereas water has no knowledge. It seems ignorant. It doesn't even have life to give. How can it give life if it doesn't itself have life? Water doesn't seem to know anything. How does it weave sophisticated and wise structures of a flower or even all the plants? So the idea, the claim here is that the Quran suggests that if people slow down and very open-mindedly contemplate, they will probably hopefully see that the water cannot be the real cause of life. There's nothing logical or necessary about water and the growth of a flower, for instance. Rather, the growth of the flower through water is a wonderful event going beyond the capacity of the water. It is actually a sign. So what appeared to be just like a simple thing, water makes flower, becomes water and flower together. This event of flourishing becomes a sign of a transcendent being who has the proper qualities to give life, a life giver, a wise being, an all-knowing being, a source of beauty, flowers beautiful too, and so on. Now, interestingly, miracle stories are tied to this because they invite us to think about natural order by interrupting our smug familiarity with it. So imagine someone bringing flowers to you every Friday night, okay? Every single Friday evening, month after month, year after year, you get flowers on Friday evenings. you start thinking that there's maybe a logical connection between flowers and Fridays. They both start with an F, at least in English. It happens over and over again, so there's something. So you start taking for granted that if it's Friday, you're going to have flowers. Then one day, in this one day, flowers don't show up on a Friday. Maybe chocolate comes, I don't know. Something other than flowers. You are shocked. Maybe nothing comes. You may be even terrified if you idolize Fridays, if you put your hope and trust on Friday evenings themselves. But if you're very open-minded, the prophet's hope, this interruption can also help you think about what you took for granted. And perhaps you may think that there is no necessary connection between Friday and flower. Maybe Friday doesn't have any secret powers to give you flowers. Maybe that consistency between flowers and Fridays was because your friend made a point to bring them on a particular day. So miracle stories are similar in that they tell us astonishing stuff, that a staff became a serpent, that a person was thrown into fire and he survived the fire, that a virgin had a baby, and so on and so forth, that thereby they make us rethink what we take for granted in everyday life. There's order in this world, sure. There's also exceptions to that order, of course. But overall, we see order. But in our everyday approach, we think order just happens. It has to be that way. And we forget to ask, what is the source of this order? And according to this view, the Quran invites, and not just the Quran, the previous scriptures as well, the prophets of God invite and nudge us to ask the question of what is the source of this order that I'm taking for granted. To go back to our example of water before, if water and life always goes together, there are maybe three main options. One is there's something secret, a secret power in the water to create life in a flower, for instance. The second would be to say that the connection between water and life is kind of random. But it's the easiest to question, because if it is random, how come it's always the same? And the third option is to say that there's this transcendent being who chooses to give life through water. And that's the third option that the Quran is really emphasizing. Now, with this perspective, we may start seeing that the miracle stories in scripture are no more wonderful than the natural world around us. In fact, the Muslim theologian Said Nursi sees miracle stories in the Quran as reenacted in the natural world, if only we have the eyes to see. For instance, he sees that the tiny roots of a plant piercing through hard rock and soil and reach for water. He says this is miracle of Moses when he struck with his staff and water gushed forth for all the tribes. That Quranic passage is being reenacted by each time a plant goes through hard soil and reaches out for water. Similarly, he looks at, in the high summer heat, how leaves, very thin leaves, remain green for a very long time. And he says that they are reciting, meaning they are reenacting, Abraham's miracle of being thrown into fire by idolaters, and yet God saying to that fire, be cool for Abraham. What Nursi gets from this is that even things like hardness, heat, these are the kind of things that are kind of seen as very strong natural causes, even they are under a divine will and power. Now, the question here is, this might sound interesting, poetic, spiritual, fine, but yeah, this I just mentioned. Forgot. So what? The question is, why is this relevant? Okay, fine. There's a divine being behind all this consistency in the world. Even if we accept that, what is its relevance for us? And the answer from the Muslim theologians that I pick is that it's not just for the sake of intellectual consistency, that there's something crucial at stake for our lives. After all, to be sure, whether you believe in God creating the flower through the water or not, you need to water your flower. And you can't tell God to say, hey, God, you know, I know you can do it without water. Come on, you know, don't tire me. Just make it grow. You need to follow respectfully the guidelines for this world. So you need to water your plant for it to grow. whether you believe it's God making it grow or water making it grow, you have to water your plant at the end of the day. So it may, the question is then, why does it matter? What difference does it make? And for them, for what is at stake is the solution to our question of transience. We are transient. And this is a line from Rumi, famous spiritual poet. He says, "Whoever has any beauty, let her know it's borrowed." When I first read it, I felt very sad about this. I was like, "Oh, it's gonna go. It's already going. It's, you know, youth is going and connections are going." My husband and I, we have a 10-year-old, and we almost evolved a ritual now. When he sleeps or when he's at school, we're like, he is growing too fast. Where is that 2-year-old? He had you know, very puffy cheeks. And where is he gone? He's like 10-year-old now. And we always are about to cry. And this is just his 10. And people are like, wait until he's 20. It's all completely gone. So that even that can pain us because we feel transient. It's all passing. That our lives are filled with separation and death awaits all of us. But it's not just death and the future, but every day is passing. This morning is gone. My son's 5-year-old is gone. I was like, even 5 was good. Yeah, now he's 10. So it's continuously passing and transient. But if, as the prophets teach us, as the Quran tells us, if the natural order is not just a mysterious thing happening somehow, but a gift that's dependent on an eternal being, then even if we know that the gift is going to finish or it's going to expire, the relationship can remain. So there's a promise of more, and that's at stake for us. If somebody gives you flowers, those flowers are going to die. But the fact that he gave it to you, that can live beyond the flower's life. So this life is passing, but if we can find something beyond this life, that there's a life giver who's unending, then it's good news. So when I looked at this picture for the second time, I didn't feel sad, actually. I was like, good, because beauty is passing anyway. My youth is passing anyway. But it is, if it is from another source, if it's not from me, that is great news, because that eternal source can give it to me again. I'm glad the source is not with me, because I know I can't hold on to it. So it can be a positive thing. Okay, I want to come back for a second. The other thing is that one might say, well, natural causes, maybe it's hard to think about them as creators, but how about laws of nature? Laws of nature seem to be making things happen. Law of gravity, creates gravity. That's how we tend to think. I'm going to skip a lot of discussions here, but basically, these regularities are descriptions of what's happening. They are not themselves creating those regularities. An example I like to give in this regard is, we say pancake in America, it's a big deal in America. I mean, you're a better breakfast here, but let's say every Sunday morning I make pancakes. And so my little son gets into the habit of pancake law. This is the pancake law. Sunday morning by 9 a.m., there's pancakes. So he gets into this habit of predicting them, and which is good, imagining me being a very predictable mother who makes pancakes every Sunday. But if my son said, we don't need the mother, we have a Sunday pancake rule that makes the pancakes, he would be confusing description with explanation. It's a good description to say there's a pancake law in this house. If he has a visitor, he can easily explain why every Sunday there's pancakes, because there is this consistency. But to say that the pancake law makes the pancakes, he lost it there, right? So, but many times we say law of gravity makes things happen. Law of osmosis makes water move, and this and that. So we need to think about natural laws, not, are they really explanations or are they really descriptions of what's happening? And the question of what is making them happen still can remain. But relating to miracles again, there's a view that says necessitarianism, in Charles Peirce's words, it claims that laws of nature don't and can't change. And I want to raise this question, do we have to believe that they can't change? Because just because something consistently happened over and over again doesn't mean that it cannot have exceptions or it cannot change. One example that my teacher, Yamina, gives, again, it can be scary if you think about it, but if you think about it from a different perspective, not necessarily. Waking up in the morning, right? I mean, I'm 40, and all these 40 years, times 365, many, many mornings I woke up. Does this increase the likelihood of me waking up tomorrow morning? No. It's still 50%. I may wake up, or many people didn't wake up this morning. They went to bed thinking that they will wake up. So just because something constantly happened doesn't mean it can't be interrupted. And the other thing is, but hopefully I'll wake up in a better world. That's my hope, even if I don't wake up here. All of us, hopefully. The other thing is the quantum physics have brought a lot of good food for thought for this, that many things that we thought were impossible in Newtonian physics are shockingly, surprisingly happening in the micro level. So that also gives us an idea to rethink laws of nature as being absolute without any exceptions. So in that regard, I believe this is my last slide. Miracles can be interpreted as making room for human freedom. Why? Because according to, if we are to interpret miracle stories as inviting us to think laws of nature as having some room for flexibility. They are still there, there's still order, and you still need to water your plant and obey the laws of gravity and so on. But there's also room for spontaneity, exception. Then it can be relevant for us as well in an existential level. Why? Because free will, human freedom, is our capacity to choose differently under exact same circumstances, okay? The conditions are identical, exactly 100% the same, but if I have freedom, I can go this way or that way, right? So freedom is our capacity to kind of transcend the circumstances in a way and to choose differently under same circumstances. If I am in a particular circumstance, and if I am really free, that means my circumstances cannot dictate my choice, then I have a freedom to go this way or that way. But if we believe laws of nature are exact and they're absolute, that means that the same circumstance will always yield the same results. But freedom is to say, well, yes, but I also have a free will that may change the course of things. So in a world that's mechanistic and deterministic, you can't really genuinely have free will, human free will. In contrast, if this world is run by a maker who creates things consistently, but also has some consideration for human choice, and then he's going to shape things accordingly, according to your choice, because he has chosen to give you freedom, and he has chosen to wiggle things around, customize things for you, then you can have genuine freedom. So by showing that the divine has freedom to make exceptions to his laws, that also gives human beings possibility of having freedom. Do I have time? 4 minutes, 5 minutes? Okay. All right. So to kind of tie up, according to Muslim theologians such as Sayyid Nursi, the regularities in the universe point to a divine power and wisdom, and they make a case against things happening randomly without purpose. There is also genuine variety and irregularity in the world, which these theologians take as a sign to divine choice and freedom. Indeed, the all-powerful and all-knowing one, this is a quote, the all-wise maker shows his power and his wisdom, and that chance can in no way interfere in his works through the regularity with which he governs the world. Such regularity takes the form of laws in nature. At the same time, through exceptions to the laws, the wonders of his habits, literally miracles, apparent changes and differences and uniqueness, God shows his will, choice, and that he is an agent with the choice under no restrictions whatsoever.
This can be good news for us as well. That doesn't mean we can be lazy and kind of skip our responsibilities and ask God to, you know, I didn't study, but give me an A from this exam. You know, I didn't cook, but still I want to find a good pancake on the table. Not in that way, not in a lazy way, but in a genuine way. This is good news in that we will do our part and we are open to breakthroughs because our past doesn't determine our future and that we are not at the mercy of impersonal mechanical laws of nature. So in sum, this is an invitation to reconsider the meaning of miracles in the scriptures, regardless of whether we initially were inclined to accept or reject them. From a Quranic perspective, it seems that the miracle stories are far from being naive stories. These stories do not call us to give up our experience of natural order or our use of it through scientific calculations. Nor are these stories mere historical events that are irrelevant to us today. Rather, they call us to transform our understanding of the ordinary. Miracle stories, by interrupting our expectations of natural causality, invite us to deeper understanding, awe, and appreciation of the world we live in. Such a shift in the way we see the natural order can take us to discovering the one behind the veils and can even solve our problem of transience. I'd like to end with a quote from Rumi, the 13th century Muslim sage Mathnavi, in which he questions a superficial approach to the Quranic story. So he's not particularly talking about miracles only, but just generally stories in the Quran. And this is his comment on the Moses story in the Quran. The quote is like this. The readers think that these are stories which happened long ago. The mention of Moses serves for a mask, but the light of Moses is your actual concern. Moses and Pharaoh are in your being. You must seek these two adversaries in yourself. End of quote. Miracle stories are not events for the past. Let us seek them around and find a message that matters for our inner selves. That's all. Thank you.
Funktioniert sehr gut. Ja, also ich werde meine Fragen auf Deutsch stellen, um Sie zu ermutigen, Ihre Fragen auch auf Deutsch zu stellen, weil es in der Vergangenheit öfters mal so gewesen, dass Sie ein bisschen brauchten im Publikum, um sich aufzuwärmen, sich zu trauen, eine Frage zu stellen, sie dann vielleicht auch noch auf Englisch zu stellen oder das Gefühl zu haben, auf Englisch stellen zu müssen. Das müssen Sie nicht. Sie können die auf Deutsch stellen. Wir haben wunderbar professionelle Übersetzer hier, die das machen, also die eine deutsche Frage auf Englisch an die Referenten stellen können und Ihnen das auch wieder zurück übersetzen können. Okay, die tragen jetzt ihre Dings nicht, deswegen mache ich das mal auf Englisch. I will ask you two first to engage each other. Do you have questions for each other's or remarks for each other's talks? Frau Yazıcıoğlu and Mr. Diamond.
Okay, I found your talk very engaging, but also at the same time, how different some of the interpretations of, for instance, your how different the interpretation is between sometimes Judaism or Jewish thinkers and Islamic thinkers. So your analogy of of relating miracles to the flower and the water, I thought that was very interesting. Only in terms of what you later talked about in terms of causality and really science works on probability. And so, for instance, you didn't mention this, but probability that you'd mentioned it was sleeping, getting up in the morning, but you know, no scientist can actually say, actually the sun will rise tomorrow. He can say 99.99999% the sun will rise. So, so miracles actually, you know, the natural laws can accommodate miracles even from a science point of view, I think. What I'd like to do is address interpretation, because I think that's at the heart of both Jewish thinkers and Islamic thinkers. And the flower and the water, for instance, you talked about the water being lifeless, whereas in most Jewish thought, water, in fact, is the most life-giving, right? And the most, right? So what I would say is interpretation really depends on a very subjective view of a metaphor, right? So the metaphor of water and light in particular is very, very dominant in Jewish thought for life, actually, for vibrancy. So I was wondering if you had something to say in terms of choice of metaphors, the way one approaches scripture, the way one interprets scripture, you know, how important that is, and
Does it work? Okay. The water, I agree with you, the water is highly regarded in the Muslim tradition as well, has a lot of symbolic significance. Actually, when it rains in many Muslim cultures, it's good news. You know, you don't say it's bad weather for rain, even if it's convenient for your picnic, you know, that's granted. But rain is good weather because rain is considered rahmah, the compassion of God almost can embodied because rain is associated with, you know, harvest and the growth of flower and so on. And at the same time, though, that rain should not be considered as the source of life. It's a place where life manifests through divine power, but it isn't the source of life. So there's also that discussion about water. The reason for this metaphor, it's not my metaphor, my example, as I said, I took it from my sources. But primarily from the Quran. The Quran talks a lot about the dead earth coming back to life after rain and how God gives life through rain. So what everybody knows is that when it rains, it's, you know, your harvest grows. That you don't need a scripture or a prophet to tell you this. Everybody knew, even in the ancient world. But what is interesting is the emphasis. It's God who's sending the rain, and it's God who's giving life through the rain. So that opened up a lot of discussion early on in Muslim theology about, is the water a source of life, or is it just a kind of a mirror to divine power?
Right. So it's a way of understanding the world, really. It's a different way of encountering the world, and one who doesn't see simply a natural law as, you know, kind of causation, is astonished, right? I mean, that's what you're saying, is astonished every time water gives birth to flowers. Mm-hmm. And so that's why I find kind of the modern thinkers, like, let's say, Buber and Rosenzweig, particularly helpful to me in the sense of a way of encountering the world, a way of being constantly astonished by the world, a way of looking at the world as enchanted, that the notion of miracles allows for, rather than a purely scientific, like you, as you said, descriptive, descriptive view of the world. So Maimonides, for instance, who I'm a big fan of, you know, talks about causation as being descriptive, but he actually has a whole passage in his famous work, his famous philosophical work, where he says, but one can never make the mistake of saying, of jumping from causation. So we say, let's say using your metaphor, that the water gives birth to the flower, that the water was created for the flower's sake, right? He says that you can never say, and that allows God to enter the world. Only God knows what the ultimate purpose is of each particular thing. And therefore, it allows you to encounter the world not just in a purely scientific, kind of dead, almost lifeless way of looking at the world as, you know, operating on scientific laws, but rather that I always have a little bit of humility, right? I mean, I think the thrust of your lecture also is that there's humility. I can be a great scientist, but also to couple that with a bit of humility that perhaps things can change, and we realize that things change on a subatomic level, right? Things can be actually in two places at the same time, which I have no clue how that works, but I'm not a mathematician. So I think miracles are important in the sense of the way, again, we encounter the world, the way we allow ourselves to be perpetually astonished by the world and enchanted by the world. Of course, there are also problems with that as well, as I ended with the evils of the world. So, I'm still not sure how to handle that, but...
I had actually a question about the evil part. This is my first time in Berlin, and this is my first time seeing some of the war memorial, I mean, genocide, I mean, Holocaust memorials in Berlin. very emotional, and I think I do follow your finishing argument emotionally, that there's or in general that there's no evil that you can emotionally say, well, I can totally see it had to happen, and then I am totally fine with it. I'm not upset with it anymore. I mean, that's kind of a contradiction in terms of the moment you say this innocent suffering, then that's the end of the matter. There's something inside us that doesn't accept innocent suffering. One thing that has been helpful for me in my personal journey was to not take that frustration with evil for granted as well, and to ask the question, what makes us so upset with evil, so frustrated at innocent suffering? Because it isn't something we picked up from the market or it's just from a particular society that we grow up. We have, little kids, they might fight over things, but when they see somebody crying, they start crying too. And this isn't because of society shaped them. We have a deep-seated frustration at suffering, and especially innocent suffering. We just can't handle it. And there's something good about that in the sense that maybe that is a sign. That's personally what helps me most, to say that I didn't get this feeling for myself. I didn't create this feeling. I don't think this is just some random mutation of my DNA. I do think that this deep-seated resentment or frustration at innocent suffering is a sign that my maker doesn't agree with this. He doesn't like evil. That's why he puts this hatred in me. And the only way I can understand it for now, that he's just allowing them time for things to manifest, but this isn't the end of matter. And I think I wanted to ask you about this. So what kind of a role does life after death play in this picture? Because if this is the end, this is really horrible. And today, as I was walking in warmer mail, I kept reminding myself that, this is not the end. This is not the end. There is more. Because whatever, I think it's amazing that this is one of the few genocides in our history of the world that actually the children of the oppressors turned around and apologized and trying to make amends as much as possible. This is one of the few cases, and it's amazing. But there's also a sense in which whatever apology is given, and I don't think the generations later are responsible for what happened because of their grandfathers. I don't think they're guilty for that. But still, whatever we can do today is not going to make up for what has happened. And so life after death becomes an amazing resource for me to personally relate to and say, this is not the end. These people are not wasted. They are compensated. And this is just a transient world where things happen, allowed to happen, but there is an eternal life. How does that play in modern Jewish thought or you're just in your personal view?
So I would say, although clearly there are these notions of a world to come, a messianic period, resurrection of the dead, all those things are very, in my study of rabbinic literature and medieval, are almost put in the background. People think that they're at the foreground. That is, even on these issues of what it means, life to come, what it means, the life after death, there's arguments about. But I think at least the ancient rabbis tended to put that aside. For instance, Maimonides, when he talks about the messianic period, says, you know what? It's not something we should really dwell upon a lot. There are all kinds of verses in the prophets. He tends to, the lion will lay down with the lamb. That's a metaphor for him because he thinks the messianic period is simply a natural resolution of history. Somehow history will work its way towards everyone in the world understanding that the pursuit of truth will be the most important thing. But they tended to put questions about Messiah, life after death, even though they're important, in the background, and rather concentrate on how people live today and how people conduct their lives. So I would say it's an important notion, but the rabbis were always wary not to make that the most important notion because then it tends to divert attention from what they thought important was this life. So for the rabbis, I think generally speaking, it's this life that's most important. What you do in this life, how you imitate God, whatever characteristics they attribute to God. And so that's the way I would respond to that. And don't think too much about that stuff. Now, you're right. I think for a lot of the thinkers I deal with, that doesn't cut it in terms of compensating for suffering in this world. The question still remains open for me, that, you know, suffering can't be compensated, at least the way I've thought about this. The death of a child, the death of a million children, if we're talking about this genocide, it's very difficult for me to use a life after death as a compensation for that. What the answer is, I'm still struggling with that. But it's very difficult for me as a philosopher, a theologian, to accept somehow that that's compensation, or it makes up for, like I said, the death of one innocent child, let alone the death of a million children or the death of millions of people. So, I'll have to leave it as a unresolvable issue at the moment, but I would say that's the general kind of trend that I follow, in at least in Jewish thinkers.
Ich guck mich mal um, ob es Meldungen gibt. Ansonsten, da hinten sehe ich jemanden und hier sehe ich auch jemanden. Ich sammle mal. Ich würde sagen, wir können zwei Fragen, ja, wenn wir zwei haben, fangen wir mal da hinten an.
Ja, vielen Dank für die beiden Vorträge. Weil wir gerade beim Thema sind, würde ich Frau Yazi Olu fragen, wie man im Islam dann mit dem Theodizee-Problem umgeht, also dem Problem, dass es Böses in der Welt gibt, wenn, Sie haben in Ihrem Vortrag gesagt, dass selbst Dinge, die uns natürlich erscheinen, weil sie durch Naturgesetze bestimmt sind, sind in letzter Konsequenz von Gott verursacht. Also verursacht er alles, also verursacht er auch das Schlechte. Und wie wird das würde mich interessieren, wie wird das im Islam aufgelöst, oder welche Meinungen gibt es da, wie geht man damit um? Also mit dem Problem, dass es auch Schlechtes in der Welt gibt, weil wir gerade beim Thema waren.
That's a great question. There's a traditional teaching in which it's a symbolic conversation there's this angel called Azrael in the Arabic sources. Azrael, maybe? I don't think we have equivalent in English, but the angel of death. So when God gives angel of death the duty to take away the souls of each human being to transport them from this to next, angel of death says, but they're going to hate me for this. and God says, according to the story, I shall place between you and them a veil of sicknesses, accidents, so they won't resent you directly, they'll resent those events. The person who's citing this is again a story from Said Nursi, but I don't think he's the first one to say that. He says, well, of course, the angel of death is also a veil. The one who takes away life is God, right? But then the veils are needed because the idea is that there is evil in the sense that there are things that are ugly in this world that we experience. But in the real reality of things, evil is relative. That's the kind of, that has been a traditional Muslim understanding, especially spiritual Sufi teachers, but also in the traditional understanding, the more classical theology, that there is relative good and evil in our perspective. And of course, we should act towards good and try to stop the evil. But in the inner reality of things, things are beautiful, because even the evil enables the goodness to come forth.
If there was no injustice, the justice in us wouldn't come forth. If there was no possibility of lying, integrity wouldn't be a virtue. If there was no ugliness, the levels of beauty wouldn't manifest, right? If everybody was equally beautiful, there would be no beauty contest. Not that I'm a fan of them, but, you know. If there is a gradation in beauty, that means there is a gradation of ugliness. How come there's a gradation in beauty? Because there's increased ugliness entering into the picture. If there is gradation in virtue, if for the beauty to manifest, the health, the goodness, virtue to manifest, in this world of ours, we need ugliness, okay? But it isn't that we're supposed to rejoice in ugliness, but to see beyond the ugliness the larger picture. So in that sense, if one is able to see the beauty in everything, in different levels, then that person can talk about God creating it. But if I am so, you know, upset that my mom is sick and I can't handle this and it's unfair for God to do this, okay, then I will blame Alzheimer's. This is what I mean? So if you ask the question, God created everything, yes. But that question cannot be understood, that question of evil, without rethinking what we consider evil. That will not make evil lovable. Oh, I'm so happy that, you know, my mom died of cancer. No. It's the one who makes you love your mom is also the one who gave you the concern for the mom. So you're not going to come into a position where you say, yes, my mom is dying today. But, or a child is dying, or, you know, or this horrible thing happened. But you can come to a place of seeing it in the larger picture, that this is not the end. She's going to a better world, or this injustice will not just remain here as injustice. This is so that what is in the hearts of people can come out, and, you know, it is for a larger purpose. But I don't want to say it this way, because it's not just an intellectual thing. When you say it and it solves, it doesn't solve the problem in the sense that the evil doesn't become something you rejoice. You still don't like evil and should work against evil. We should not allow genocides to happen. But in Islamic theology, it's worse for us to think that things are out of control than to think that some things that I don't understand are allowed to happen. So there is still this in the Muslim tradition, but the way the questions are asked, the attitude of those questions are a bit different from the way in which they have been asked in the Christian tradition or more recently in the Jewish tradition. There are different explanations. There's actually a book from 1980s, I believe, in English that says the best of all possible worlds. So Ghazali, this 12th century thinker, he says this sentence that, you know, this is the best of all possible worlds. And then the theologians kept, you know, throughout the centuries, this went for centuries after his death, they're like, he said this, but that doesn't make sense. And all kinds of reasons, evil one of them, or just climate conditions. Some people were like, this is too humid where I live. I'm sure it could be better, you know. Like, so. And then the whole discussion they had about this and what Ghazali may have said as a kind of major theologian. So yes, you can think about better alternatives, but in a sense, this is the best possible world. And what does that mean? That's kind of a lot of discussion. But just to say that the question of evil did arise throughout Muslim history, but they never, in the mainstream forums, they never divorced it from God being with us at all times, even in the most horrible tragedy. And I think one more thing I can say is the Quranic vocabulary, it's strange. I know it sounds strange, but the only evil one can do is to herself or himself. But even if I kill somebody, God forbid, yes, you hurt yourself. Because that person, God will give him a better world. But in the day of judgment, you will face as the murderer. You're in the big trouble. You're the loser. In a sense, nobody can harm somebody else, even if you're abusing that person. Because God can turn that abuse into something good for that person or something for her growth or some other thing that I may not necessarily directly see. The only loser is the person who hurts others. So when you oppress somebody, you actually only oppress yourself. Even though, of course, outwardly we should stop that person and all that. I don't know if that's clear. But I could go on, but that's what that might be.
you want to add something? Or,
I mean, from a Jewish perspective, I think you asked about theodicy. I think, generally speaking, a theodicy now is untenable. A theodicy means a justification of God. And I would start really with way back, there's been a few thousand years of thought, but the book of Job, for instance, you have an entire book of Job that in my reading of it, rejects theodicy. That is, the friends, Job suffers unbelievable suffering, and we know at the beginning of the book that it is innocent suffering. We know at the beginning of the book that he doesn't deserve the suffering. People often forget that it's a setup, right? It's a setup. And then for 40 or some odd chapters, the friends are engaged in theodicy, in one way or another, trying to justify God. At the end of the book, God comes out and says, those friends sinned against you. That is, their attempts to justify me were an insult to you, and actually made your suffering even deeper. Even deeper, because Job understands that he doesn't deserve this, and when they keep on telling him that God has done this for whatever reason and you deserve it, it simply deepens the insult. God's answer at the end is not to compensate you or that you'll have a future life. It simply ends, there's a lot that's been discussed. It ends in that, were you there when I created the world? Something like that, right? That is... But one thing I know at the end of this book is that your friends were wrong. Your friends were engaged in justifying me, and that was wrong. And they're actually sinners. They're actually considered sinners for the enterprise of trying to justify me at the cost of you. That, to me, is a very important lesson of it.
Clarify, maybe it was already clear, but clarify that when I say putting it in the larger picture doesn't necessarily mean that you deserved it. In the Islamic tradition, the notion is that not all suffering is deserved. You don't only get what you deserve. It's more about this life is meant to have both good and bad for a larger purpose than just punishing you or rewarding you. So just want to add that.
Sure. Hier vorne gab es noch eine Meldung. Ja. Kommt gleich das Mikrofon zu Ihnen.
Yes, hello. Thank you very much for your talks. I have an issue to discuss with you, Professor Diamond, with regards to claiming that science is basically lifeless, mechanical, as you also say. I'm just trying to think about this in other terms. You know, scientists who are studying nature are quite often in wonder of what they're observing, okay? And we are discovering things all the time. So for instance, before 500 years, many people believed that a lot of phenomena in the world were all God's will. So whatever God wanted to happen. Today, 500 years later, we have explanations for a lot of these things. But we still don't have all the answers. Okay, you mentioned something being able to exist simultaneously. There are exceptions to laws of nature at the quantum level. We don't understand these things yet. But if we follow the scientific method, we will come to answers. The paradox is, the more we understand, the more questions arise. So we never reach a point where we have all the answers. But if you follow the scientific method, you're going towards the truth in some way that you can build upon. But if you're always claiming that it's God's will that explains everything else like that, you're limited. You will not go forward. You will not understand anything. So do you think this is a reasonable argument?
You know what? I pretty well agree with you on everything you said. I didn't mean to say at all that science is useless or science doesn't have a purpose. I meant to say that a purely scientific view, as you said, that think that science can provide us with all the answers, and just looking at the world through formulae and mathematics and right and causation can lead to a kind of cold view of the world. Now, I think what you said at the end is very important and something I completely agree with. That is, at the end of the day, if for anything else, the idea of God is important for humility. That is, I think for scientists to think that they will have all the answers. I never said that, you know, we need science to say that A may lead to B, that A causes B, that kind of thing. But what you said at the end is very important. That is, the more we know, the more we don't know. And I've learned something, particularly from Maimonides, and this is the 12th century, is that actually the purpose of life is to know enough, to study all your life, so that you truly reach the point where you realize you don't know. That is, lots of people, right, who are ignoramuses, claim they know everything. But to reach a point in life, and I think this is where science should always head and should always be wary of, is that I want to reach the most educated point in my life, an educated ignorance, right? It's truly the greatest physicist in the world. I think only somebody like Einstein can truly say, I don't actually know something, right? For me to say that, you know, so what, right? Of course I don't know anything. So I would agree with you absolutely. I don't mean at all to say that science is lifeless, but that science should, be accompanied with something that allows us to be astonished and allows us to understand that the laws of causality are not the ultimate in the world. And we may be even finding, they call that Biggs Hogs, God particle. I mean, there's a reason they call it a God particle, right? I think that was a very interesting thing. That is, they themselves have kind of introduced things that don't follow necessarily all the laws. Maybe they will find a unified, right? Maybe one day there are those black holes where we ultimately reach a point where all physical laws break down. Perhaps that's God. I don't know. But it is a point where we'll have to say, we don't really know. We don't really know.
Right now?
And I think right now we don't know a lot more things than Aristotle was willing to admit.
Do you want to add something, Yasuchoza, or otherwise
Sure, yes. I think definitely I agree with the notion that the more we explore, we have... I guess you didn't say this directly, but there's the notion that the more we explore nature, the more we have reason for wonder. Yeah, you said this. And then that can, from a theological perspective, that can bring us a deeper sense of the wonder about the Creator. We just need to be careful, because there is science and there's interpretation of science, and oftentimes, in the way we're taught science, the two are mixed up. So many things that we think we know now are actually, we don't know. We just know our way in the world more. So you know to put fertilizers to get more, harvest, or we have more technology. But in terms of understanding, I don't think we have come a long way. I mean, even the villager 500,000 years ago, they knew how to till the ground and, what season goes with what. They did have kind of their scientific knowledge. So religion is not there to supplement that or kind of replace that. It's more to help us make sense of that. To say, it's one thing to describe, let's say, the sun. And it's this far away. And, it's this hot. And this kind of reactions are happening in the sun. If it was this much closer, it would burn. And if it was a bit farther away, it would be too cold, and so on. And just think that expansion replaces the notion that the sun is placed there intentionally and I'm a guest in this house. This world is my house, and this is my lamp. This notion, this metaphor, can strike as a kind of too old. You know, it's a Quranic reference. You know, the sun is a lamp. Everybody knows the sun shines, but it's not about saying the sun shines. Nobody needed the prophet to tell them the sun shines. Everybody knew that. But the point is, when you say the sun is a lamp, it is saying this is your home, and it's intentionally placed there. And today some people think that just because we are able to give a lot of details that ancients didn't know about how far the sun is and what kind of reactions are happening chemically in the sun, that somehow we don't need to make sense of this fact. And somehow to say all of these, you know, information, facts, has to go with saying that it just happens that it's there. It happens that we're just randomly here. It happens that we're making use. We're just kind of parasites somehow surviving in a world that kind of somehow is working to our advantage. That view, if this is science, then we need to question it. If this is not science, then we need to be clear that this is not science. This is an interpretation of the world, an interpretation that says things are there, we can make use of them, and they're just randomly there. And that's a big claim that I don't think is necessarily tied to finding facts that we discovered today. So I think we want to distinguish between science and its interpretation, or what part of what we read in the science textbook is really fact or theory, and what part of it is a particular naturalistic interpretation.
Ich guck noch mal rum, hab aber Sie gesehen. I have one question for you, Professor Diamond. You were talking about traditional commentators or medieval commentators of the Bible being somehow uncomfortable in different ways about miracles, and especially I'm interested in this relationship between because they being uncomfortable in order to ward off magical thinking. Why were they so uncomfortable with magical thinking? I mean, what's
so
at stake here?
Yeah. So, first of all, you know, the Bible itself is very, very down on all kinds of magic. That was considered to be efficacious, right? That it was actually considered to be real. So that they're worried that to lead a life that is conditioned by miracles, right, could lead to the kind of this magic. That is, you lead to kind of a pagan idea where I perform certain rituals and I can get God to do some things for me. Those were the sources I brought that showed a discomfort. In fact, you even have some passages in the Talmud saying they were so uncomfortable with it, saying that miracles no longer happen. Miracles no longer happen. It goes along with a lot of things I said, like the prophetic period has ended, because they understood revelation. Of course, this is problematic with subsequent revelations, Christianity and Islam, but in terms of what the rabbis understood, that there was one revelation. There was kind of, if you want to call it, one miraculous encounter between God and his people. And God's word was given that one time. And then it's a human job to simply interpret God's word. God's word is only heard through interpretation, So they're always worried about miracles, about people speaking in the name of God, because they see that is very dangerous. We see it in the modern period too. Lots of people, you know, claim to speak in the name of God, and sometimes we see, disaster happens. In the States, you had Jonestown. I mean, that's just something that So they actually said, almost as a legal declaration, prophecy has ceased. Miracles have ceased. Not all passages agree with this. Again, the Talmud is. But by and large, and they actually have a legal ruling that one does not rely on a miracle. That is, one conducts his life the way one should. One confronts whatever situation there is to the utmost of human capacity and let God do his work. So that's what I meant by the rabbis are, by and large, generally here and now oriented. because they see a danger and that kind of thing. I'll just give a little anecdote. There's a joke, some of you might know it, where a very Orthodox Jewish guy, you know, he believes in God, very faithful, he's drowning. And a boat comes along and says, here, we're, says, no, God will save me, right? a helicopter comes down and says, come on, we'll lift you up. No, God will save me. You know, I'm relying on God. And then ultimately he drowns, goes up to heaven, and he meets God, and he says, God, why didn't you perform a miracle for me? He goes to God and says, what do you mean? I sent you a helicopter. I sent you people a boat, right? So kind of that joke is you know, kind of trivial, but it kind of points out, I think, a rabbinic mindset, which is kind of apropos what I was saying before, about putting less stress on hereafter, a life to come, and putting more stress on what one does in the here and now. I mean, there wasn't even, one could say, a belief system until Maimonides came along in the 12th century. Through the entire Talmud, basically it's conduct. It's how one conducts oneself, how one, in interpersonal relationships, and relationships with God. So that's in a nutshell, my answer.
Is that something that's reconcilable with Muslim?
Yeah, because if you look at the jurisprudence, Islamic law, the way that the jurists talked about how to drive guidelines for everyday life from the sacred sources. Among the sources is not miracles. Miracles are not accepted. You cannot say, well, I think God wants us to do this based on the dream I saw last night. They're like, no, you may have had the miracles dream, or miracles don't count as evidence. And that, they were clear about that as well. That only the sources are sacred sources, like the Quran or Muhammad's practice, and then several other things that are drawn from them. But in terms of, you know, having an interpretation to be applied in everyday life, miracles didn't count. That didn't mean miracles cannot happen. It's just that they don't count in this kind of legal interpretation matters. So there is a parallel there.
Einer, jemand hatte sich noch gemeldet. War das noch? Genau, da hinten. Sie noch mal? Sonst hier noch? Ich guck. Warum?
Ja, erstmal schönen Dank an die beiden Vortragenden. Ich habe eine Frage. In diesen unruhigen Zeiten, die wir heutzutage haben, wo würden Sie da im globalen Maßstab in jüngster Zeit Wunder sehen?
You want to go first? Once again, you know, I'm very wont to call anything a miracle. I kind of go with some of these modern thinkers that I don't critique somebody who has encountered things in life that they feel is a miracle. So I'll give you just an example. In my community, I grew up basically in a survivor community, Holocaust survivors. Toronto has a very large survivor community. People would say, you know, tell their stories, and they would say, this was a miracle, right, that I survived. Now, if I looked at this as a philosopher, right, and subjected it to logic, I would say it's almost offensive, because the guy to the right of you, the woman to the left of you, the child to the back of you, right, and the child in front of you, died, right? So that person in his own experience feels this is a miracle, and he could say it's a miracle. I'm never going to question that. From an objective point of view, it almost would seem arbitrary. So I'd have to say, in this world, I don't see too many miracles, especially when I brought in Hans Jonas after Auschwitz. My late teacher was another famous German Jewish thinker, actually, who I had the very privilege of studying with, Emil Fackenheim. So I studied with him at University of Toronto. His idea was that Auschwitz actually spelled the death a philosophy, spelled the death to lots of things we think about when we associate with God. He considered Auschwitz to issue a 614th commandment. So that some of you might know that there are six traditionally known 613 commandments. There's a 614th commandment to survive as Jews. And he considers the survival, simply the physical survival of Jews after Auschwitz, to be a miracle, to be a miracle. Now, what he means by that, I'm still not quite sure, even after having studied with him. So I'll have to pull back on what I see in the world. That'll be my response, and leave you with more questions.
Is that the kind of miracle that the Rabbi Herzog was talking about?
So I think Rabbi Herzog was talking about a real miracle. The way I interpret him is that the way I interpret survivors when they tell me about the miracle that happened. This was a real miracle that they experienced. Mm-hmm. I don't doubt that for a moment.
Yeah. Okay.
From an objective point of view, I'm not here to judge that. From a scientific point of view, what actually happened. But I think to objectively say, from my standpoint, that this was a miracle when so many others seemed to be equally deserving, of course, again, who am I to say, died, that's another question.
I think in order to see miracles, we just need to slow down a bit more. We're in a kind of fast-paced life, and definitely the news always brings us the worst stories. Just today, somebody just I met when I was touring, she said, "Is America safe?" I said, "Yes, I live there, it's safe." She said, "You know, so-and-so said, you know, somebody went there and it wasn't safe." And I said, "Well," and then in the news, you know, things are not safe. Yes, but, you know, that's the news. We can watch the news, definitely, we should follow, but if we want to know what's going on, but really, they bring us the worst. So that to restore the hope, I think we need to step away a bit from the news and see the miracle. I think miracles are there to be experienced. They are relational. I wouldn't say they are subjective in the sense that they are kind of wishful thinking. I know. Cheesy ideas, not in that sense, but they are subjective in the sense of relational, that things are a miracle for you if you can pay attention and are open to see them as such. If not, if you could say this is a miracle, then it wouldn't be a miracle. So the Quran also talks a lot about, it doesn't use the term miracle literally, but it uses this term sign. And signs are there for those who are open to see. The same person can look at the same, two people can look at the same thing and can't see the sign. A good example is take a piece of writing. I don't, for instance, read Chinese. So if you show me Chinese calligraphy, I say it's beautiful, but I have no idea it has meaning. But if somebody else looks at it and she knows Chinese, then she reads a message too. So we're looking at the same thing. I don't get any message. I just see a calligraphy, whether, you know, I like it. Looks nice or doesn't look nice, the other person actually gets a meaning. So you can look at the same thing and not see it. So I would say miracles are relational. For us to experience them, we need to slow down and also question the things that we take for granted. There are miracles. And yes, some of the global stuff are going crazy, but that doesn't mean that's the end or everybody is crazy. Some of our leaders are crazy, definitely, but thankfully, they are allowed time, but I don't think they are the final decision makers. So I'll leave with that hope. I do have hope, but I don't want to limit it to just an external reality. It's also internal reality that we can discover.
Ja, also ich danke Ihnen herzlich für Ihre schöne Frage. Und würde, wenn es jetzt keine weiteren Fragen mehr gibt, ich gucke noch mal ruhig in die Runde, unser Gespräch hier abschließen, mich ganz herzlich bei den beiden Rednern bedanken. Es sei denn, Sie haben noch etwas hinzuzufügen. You have to add something or want to say something as a concluding note, because I don't see any more questions.
I just want to thank you all for coming. Yeah. This was a wonderful audience. Very excellent questions, and I, thank the Jewish Museum and thank Sophia and Sitara and Yulia for all the work they did in preparing this. It's truly a miracle that this came came all together. So thank you very much.
Dann bedanke ich mich auch nochmal ganz herzlich bei Ihnen für Ihre Aufmerksamkeit und für Ihr Erscheinen heute und Ihre Teilnahme an dieser Diskussion heute Abend. Und eine Vorlesung wird es noch geben in dieser Reihe und dann geht es auch schon mit der nächsten Ringvorlesung ab dem Winter los. Ja, dann entlasse ich Sie in den schönen Sommerabend. Die Linden blühen wunderschön. Für mich ein Wunder, das riechen zu können. Die sind hier sehr präsent in Berlin und genießen Sie es. Ja, vielen Dank. Applaus